To open this evening, I'm just going to read this one verse from the end of Luke's Gospel, Luke 24. And it reads, "So they drew near to the village where they were going. Jesus acted as if he was going further, but they, the two men who he had walked with, urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent.' So he, Jesus, went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with them, he took the bread, and he blessed it, and broke it, and he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he, Jesus, vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, 'Did not our hearts burn within us, whilst he talked to us on the road, whilst he spoke to us, and opened the scriptures to us?'" And with this evening, let us come before the Lord and just ask him for his blessing. Father, we think about these words, about how your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, walked on the first Sunday, the Resurrection Sunday, all those years ago, with his disciples who were lost, his disciples who were mourning, his disciples who were confused. And Father, we thank you that he went to them and comforted them. And Father, for us, Lord, as we think about our lives, we think, Father, about how we at times can be lost, how we at times can be in the darkness, how we at times, Lord, can wonder, where are you? What are you doing? Where is the hope? And we thank thee, O Lord, that in the darkest moments, in the bleakest corners of our life, in the darkest moments of history, we realize that we can say, as Christians, we're winning. Father, we thank thee that your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. And Lord, we thank thee that in the dark moment here with these two disciples, when Jesus was at table and took the bread and broke it, their eyes were opened. So Heavenly Father, tonight as we come to your word, the living bread, the living word, we ask Heavenly Father that you will feed us by your Spirit, to help us to stand upon our feet, to renew us, to refresh us. O Lord God, help us, we pray. Help us to see Jesus and the plans you have. Help us to see glory upon glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our theme for this evening, if you have a Bible, do turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11. And you will have noticed that I have preached a little bit from Hebrews chapter 11 in the past. I've preached from a little bit in chapter 12, and you will notice I've even touched on a few little strings, pulled a few chords in Hebrews chapter 13. But tonight I just want to take a few minutes for us to study and observe and look at the faith of Abraham. And the reason I want us to look at the faith of Abraham this morning is because we've been going through the book of Revelation. We've been coming to the climax of it. And I have been arguing for the fact that when John is taken up for the last and final time, the fourth time in the Spirit, all the way in Revelation chapter 21, verse 10, when he is taken up in the Spirit, he sees the bride of Christ. He sees the holy city descending. He sees, if you will, the holy of holies, the dwelling place of man. He sees where God tabernacles with man. And as we're going to see in the coming weeks, nations reappear in the book at the end of Revelation, and nations are healed. Or rather, nations have the potential to be healed by coming to the tree of life. And so I have been arguing that this city that John sees, this bride that John sees, is the church. And I have been arguing that when you and I as Christians preach the gospel to people, we are bringing them healing. Now, they will not see it as healing. They will react to it. But that is expected. It is expected because when you are under treatment for cancer, when you are under treatment for massive surgery or operations, you may need some strong antibiotics. You may need some very, very strong medication. And so when you take your medication, when you take your antibiotics, what are you doing? Your body is saying, right, I'm not liking this. There might be a reaction to begin with. But then you see shortly after that the medication you are taking benefits you. The medication that you need is helping you. The medication that you're on is actually for your benefit. And so it is when you turn around and you tell people they are a sinner and they need Jesus Christ, you are giving them medicine. You are giving them living water. You are telling them, listen, you are filthy and disgusting and unclean, just as I am, and you need a savior. And they're going to react. And those who don't want Christ, well, we pray for them and we wish them every blessing. But we also know that to those who we do preach Christ to, something may happen. Something glorious may happen. They may be healed. And the end of Revelation turns around and tells us that there is a city that descends. And for us, the book of Hebrews tells us something fascinating too. The book of Hebrews tells us that long ago, in chapter 1, our ancestors were spoken to through the mediation of angels and prophets. And the book of Hebrews says, it is no longer so. Jesus Christ has come. And for us this evening, I just want us to look at the city to come from the perspective of Abraham, a city that I am taking to be the end city, the church descending when John is taken up in the spirit. And he sees for the fourth and final time this glorious vision where there is the ability to be healed and this ability to be cleansed. Now, it should go without no obvious need for me to say, but Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 tells us what faith is. Verse 1, now faith is the assurance or the confidence of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. That is what faith is. Faith is the confidence of things hoped for and a conviction of things not seen. And Abraham, we're going to study and have a little look at Abraham this evening, because Abraham, it is said, believed God, trusted God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. And what did Abraham have to go on? All the way back in your Old Testament, when God appears to Abraham and he takes Abraham out under the night sky, he says to Abraham, look at the stars. So shall your descendants be. And Abraham trusted God and it was counted to him as righteousness. What did Abraham have to go on? One thing, the word of God. He only had God's word to trust on. He could look at the stars and say, wow, that sounds like a great idea. He could look around him and he could be like, wow, could I picture my descendants filling this land? That sounds great. But the only confidence that Abraham had was the word of God. The only thing that Abraham had as true assurance was, you have said it, God, therefore it is true. And for us, after we establish what faith is, you get reading and you start off with Abel, but just jump with me very quickly to verse 8. For verse 8. And then we are going to jump again. And we're going to jump to chapter 12. And tonight we're just going to look at the city that was promised. And so, verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going, not knowing whither. And by faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. So he is sent from his place, and he goes to a place of promise, and he's living in tents. Verse 10. For he, this is Abraham, was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. And then you get the story of Sarah. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants, as many as the stars of heaven, and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. He goes on later on to talk about Abraham again and his faith in offering up Isaac, but I'm not interested in that this evening. I'm interested in verse 10. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. And before we continue in Hebrews and go to chapter 12, I'm just going to read one verse to you again to get the real essentialness of this down. Ephesians chapter 2, for through him, through Christ, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. And who's the we both? Is it the apostles and the Ephesians? Yes. Is it the Jews and the Gentiles? Yes. We both have access to one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, in other words, illegal immigrants, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and of the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Hebrews chapter 12 then picks up this theme about faith again in the opening verses, talking about how we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. In other words, read your Old Testament and see how people suffered and struggled. They are not there watching you, cheering you on like the Olympics. No, because as I've said before, if you watch Usain Bolt run, you have no idea how much training goes into it. You have no idea how he is training, eating, how fast he goes. You haven't got a clue. To be a witness to something means that you have done it. And so you read your Old Testament saints and you go, okay, you've done it. You have had faith, you've sinned. You have had hope, love, joy, peace. You've sinned. You got back up. Okay, you didn't. You stayed down. You said, I don't want God. Fine, down. You here have picked yourself back up. You read all these characters, all these stories throughout your Old Testament. And Hebrews chapter 12 tells us, hold on a minute. Keep running, keep going, because you're surrounded by men and women who know what it's like to suffer, know what it's like to have doubts, know what it's like, and the ultimate sin that clings to us so closely is unbelief. Unbelief. And the author to the Hebrews throughout chapter 12 turns around and tells us, stop thinking about yourselves, Stop thinking about your situation. Think about Christ. Think about his struggles. Think about what he endured. Think about the hostility he himself suffered. Verse 4 of chapter 12, in your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood, which is true. Which is true. And he goes on and on to talk about this, using this wonderful metaphor of running to say, come on, lift up your heads, lift up your hands, run. Verse 12, run. And then we get this interesting language from verse 18. So Hebrews chapter 12, verse 18. And he is talking to the Hebrew Christians at the time when they are tempted to turn back to the old covenant. They are tempted to say, hold on a minute, was Jesus Christ really the way, the truth, and the life? We're getting a little bit of persecution over here. Is this really the way things are? And as I've said before, up until AD 70, the old covenant and the new covenant overlap. And there is a period of grace. And there is a period of grace there for those who turn around and tell Pilate, crucify the Messiah, may his blood be on us and our children. And God says, I will offer you grace for you to repent. And some do repent, and those who harden their hearts, nevertheless, everything that's going to come on this generation will never be seen again in such an awful way. How can that be true? Because the old covenant alone today does nothing. After AD 70, the old covenant is void. It is void, finished, done. If you want to have old covenant blessings, you have to come to the new covenant, which is through Jesus Christ. And so these Christian men and women who are Jews, the first Christians are Jews. They are tempted to run back to the old covenant. And your book, or to the letter of the Hebrews, this letter of so much glorious theology, ends up with, hold on a minute, there is a city to come. And it reads from verse 18, for you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sign that Moses said, I tremble in fear. So all this language is talking about the old covenant, where it's given on Mount Sinai, and there is just fire and cloud and smoke, and the Lord says, Moses, tell the people not to come anywhere near. They'll be struck down. They'll be struck dead. I am holy, they are not holy. Tell them quickly. And all this language here about fear and tremble. And he goes on to say, indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. Verse 22, but you have come to Mount Zion. You have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to the innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. Who are the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven? The first fruits. And to God, to judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. All this language here telling the Hebrews, telling those who have put their faith in Christ, who are tempted to turn back to the old covenant, turn back to Mount Sinai, turn back and say, hold on a minute, was Jesus the Messiah? And they're saying, not only was Jesus the Messiah, hold fast, but you have come to the new heavenly Jerusalem. You have come. Verse 25 through. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject him who warns us from heaven? At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of things that are shaken, that is, things that have been made, in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. All this language here is talking about what I am going to take it as yet once more I will shake not only the earth but also the heavens. And you have seen that throughout the entire book of Revelation. The book of Revelation in its essence is the Olivet Discourse. It is the judgment of this generation. It is the wrath that came. It is the removal of the old, the coming of the new. And we see this heavenly city that is promised here to these Christians saying, keep going, keep fighting, keep praying, keep worshipping. And how do you fight? Well, you fight through word, prayer, and sacrament. That is how you fight. He is going to shake the heavens once more, and what remains will not be shaken. You go, amen. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. All this language about receiving a kingdom, receiving a city, receiving hope built upon foundations where the new Jerusalem, here we have, on Mount Zion, where the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem with innumerable angels, and you go, amen. That is what Revelation chapter 21 verses 10 through is talking about. It is talking about a place where you and I, day and night, can go to the Lord and we can worship him. We can cry to him. We can confess to him. We can plead with him. We can beg him. We can ask him. We can go to the Father any time that we wish. The problem is we don't because of our sin. That's all that stops us. That's all that stops us. In John chapter 4, the woman at the well, you have that great scene where Jesus says to her, give me some water. And there's a striking thing that happens. She gets water out of the well. They have a wonderful theological discussion. And he turns around and they're talking back and forth. And she says, we worship on this mountain. You Jews worship on this mountain where you have your temples. And Jesus says, yeah, all of that's coming to an end. The hour is at hand where you will no longer be worshiping here or here. You'll be worshiping in spirit and in truth. What does that mean geographically? It means wherever a Christian is, you can worship. Wherever somebody is, wherever one Christian or two or four or 10 or 20 are, you can worship. We no longer need to go to the mountain. We no longer need to go to the tabernacle. We no longer need to go up to Solomon's temple. We no longer need to go to Herod's temple. No, because God says, no, no. You are to worship me in spirit and in truth. And when Jesus ends his discourse with this woman, something stunning also happens. He starts with, give me a drink. And she pulls some water out. They have a conversation about water. They have a conversation about living water. And when she runs back to the people, she leaves her flask, if you will, her jar of water there. And why is that important? Because that is exactly what happens when you and I go to the Father and we go to the heavenly Jerusalem. We ask him, Lord, will you take away what I have to offer and give me something better? This is all I have. I only have earthly stuff, Lord. That's all I have. Can you transform it and give me something more? And the woman pulls up this jar of water, leaves it. They have a theological discussion and she runs back telling the people the glorious wonder of Christ. He has given her what she wanted. And she asks, Lord, will you give me living water? Where can I find it? And Christ says, I am it, come and drink from me. And here we see this city that Abraham had hoped for, had longed for. When he looked out under the sky and he saw all of the stars, and he said, Lord, you have said so. You have said so. And tonight, as we think about these things, as we keep chipping away, as we keep looking at different angles on the book of Revelation, different angles on what it means to worship, different angles on what it means for you and I tonight to not only have access to the Holy Temple, not only have access to be part of this living bride that descended this heavenly Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. Not only can that be true, not only can we be healed, not only can we receive living water, not only can we drink from Christ, but we too can go out and offer it to someone else as well. All it takes is just one person. Just one person to listen to what you are saying, and you have no idea what will happen. I say this because something quite amazing happened last night in politics, where you have one of the Kennedys who turns around and says, me and Mr. Trump, we do not agree on many things, but I'm stepping down because I think that this man on this policy is more righteous. It took one person, and he happened to be a Kennedy, and he said those words. How much more greater could it be if one day one man, like a Mr. Kennedy, like a Sadiq Khan, like a Keir Starmer, say, hold on a minute, we've got everything wrong, we need to worship Christ. Now, I appreciate that is a long shot. But all it takes is one. All it takes is one. Jesus Christ, in his hour of need, said to everyone, I'm going to the cross and I'm dying for you. None of you are going to be round. You're all going to betray me. He did it. He changed the world. And he said to his disciples after, I'm about to go to the right hand of the Father. Go and change the world. All authority has been given to me. Because I have all authority, go and preach about me and watch the world transform. Watch the world change. All it takes is one person. All it takes is one person to be converted who can convert someone else, who preaches and the Holy Spirit converts someone else, and they preach and the Holy Spirit converts someone else, and suddenly you have not only a bride descending and a living temple where we can go to the Lord day and night, 24 hours a day, but we also have a temple being built up. A heavenly city, a heavenly Jerusalem here on earth that has many living stones, many Christians scattered around the world, building up this heavenly city, this Jerusalem, that is founded upon the saints, founded upon the 12 tribes, founded upon the 12 apostles. And this leads me tonight to just end with this. I know in my own life that there are many fears and many doubts. And I know that in your lives there are that too. Because we're human. Because we're easily tempted. Because it's tough out there in the big world. The question that I leave you all with tonight is simply this. When you read your Bible, do you trust what God says? Do you believe His word has the power to change lives? Do you believe that He Himself wants you to be transformed from glory into glory? Don't tell me you don't feel it. I know you don't feel it. I'm asking you, is it true? And if you tell me I don't read my Bible, I just smile, knowing, well, what do we expect to change then? Everybody in the Old Testament, everybody in the New Testament time knew all the scriptures. They knew them back to front, upside down, left and right. They were searching for the truth. They were searching for the heavenly Jerusalem. You and I this evening need to not only look at the word a little bit more, study the word a little bit more, but we need to do what Abraham did. Look. Is it possible? Not sure. What did Abraham have to go on? God's word. Look at the stars, Abraham. They will be like your descendants. Look at the stars, Abraham. The new Jerusalem will come. Look to the stars, Abraham, as verse 10 says of chapter 11, for Abraham was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. How is God building your life this evening? Building the lives of those around you, your families, your friends, and sometimes in building, what we need to recognize is for something new to come, the old needs to be chipped away. A brick needs to be removed. The plaster needs scraping off. Sometimes we have to look at things and go, we want peace, peace. But sometimes to get that perfect peace, we need to bring a little bit of roughness, some sandpaper. Bring a little bit of chipping awayness. How is God building your life? How is God building the lives of those who you love around you? How is God loving you? And for us tonight, I just close with this. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 to 3. Lay aside every weight and every sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Looking to Jesus, who is the founder and perfecter of the hope. And every weight and every sin which clings so closely is unbelief. It is always unbelief. Has God really said? Has God really said, if I come to His Son, He will give me everlasting life? Your Bible says yes. So come. And with that, let us just close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we think on these complex and difficult things, Lord, about looking forward, looking backwards, being in the present. Father, as we have looked at and studied, as Lord, we have considered and thought about your word, your promises, your truth, and those, Lord, who looked forward to the coming of Christ, Father. We thank Thee that we look back. We thank Thee, Heavenly Father, that we see the glory of Him. We thank Thee, Heavenly Father, that every day He is chipping away at our sin. Every day He is chipping away at the hardness of our lives. Every day He is telling us, will you read my word? Will you trust my promises? Will you trust me? Father, Lord, we confess that we don't. And we ask your forgiveness when we cling so easily to unbelief. And Father, we ask for your forgiveness when we seek to put up wallpaper over a crack without doing anything about it. Father, help us to deal with the chips in our lives, the cracks in the foundations, the hard yards, Lord, of getting into the heart, into our hearts, and having them cracked open, Lord, so that you, Heavenly Father, can do open heart surgery. And you can transform and transplant our hearts of stone into hearts of flesh, hearts of love, hearts of obedience to Thee. Father, we ask for courage to pray, Lord, for those in our lives who let us down, who are disappointments. Father, we ask, Lord, for the courage to stand up to them as well. We ask, Heavenly Father, that we will preach Christ and Christ alone, Christ crucified, Christ resurrected, Christ ascended. Give us, Lord, that strength and that courage to know that we are part of the bride today, that heavenly Jerusalem. And Father, that preaching your Son offers living water, healing to the nations, healing, house building, O Lord God, to everyone who comes and sups. Father, we thank Thee for your Son. We thank Thee, Heavenly Father, for your Holy Spirit. And we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will help us to come to Thee with every petition, every plea, every need. Help us, Lord, to think about how you are building our lives. And Father, help us in the darkness, when it is dark, when, Lord, there are doubts, when, Father, it appears that you are doing nothing, help us to trust in Thee and to work through those difficult moments, Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for that word. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you, Lord, are with me. Lord, we pray that for everyone here tonight. We pray that, Lord, for those who cannot be with us. We pray that, Lord, for anyone listening, that you, Father, through any dark valleys, in the moments of darkness, you will give them the assurance, O Lord, that you are with them. Help us, Lord, to run to the heavenly city, to lay our pleas and petitions down at your feet, saying, Alleluia, what a Saviour. So bless us, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen.